Okay, so we're done with the sales tax. What do we move on to next?
Any questions?
Oh, okay. So let's talk about the types of things. So we're gonna walk backwards again. So now we're all getting ready to do our taxes, mm-hmm. whether it's with accountants or whether we're doing it online. We still have to have our paperwork ready. So can you talk a little bit about what type of paperwork you would love to see an artist walk in with, not a shoebox filled with stuff you want? How is the best way for someone, for us who don't love numbers, don't want to deal with spreadsheets, but you guys need us to be organized. How do we organize for you? How does an artist organize for an account so that when we get to you, you can spend less time saving us money?
So the categories that we spoke about, separated by categories.
Okay.
So you've got all of your memberships, have all of your memberships together.
Okay.
And with the total, you don't have to put it into a spreadsheet.
Okay.
It doesn't have to be in a spreadsheet, but you know, put all your memberships together and you've got a total on what the memberships are.
Okay.
Yeah, an envelope. It can be written on it with a sticky note on top of it with the total.
Okay.
But just separating things by categories. That's going to help save us time and you money.
Okay.
So
and what about same with income? Do we just or it's just
right.
income?
Separate all your income would be good unless you have different types of income.
I did separate the types of income.
Okay, so if one is you got paid by someone to help them paint the mural, but other income are actually paintings that you sell, those would be two different types of income. They should be separated. One is kind of like part-time help where you're helping someone
if
you're getting paid. Okay.
Yeah, and if you have you've got income from your actual pieces and then you've got grant income or you've got like that. Separate
those out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Then your expenses, separate your auto expenses from your supplies and
your utilities.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We have a comment about this. Ken says he uses QuickBooks Freelance. It's awesome.
Oh, QuickBooks is wonderful. I absolutely love QuickBooks.
It's easier for us as tax person.
It is easy.
Yeah. Is that a different version, freelance version, or what?
They have several different versions. They've got one now actually for the self-employed person who would file a Schedule C, and you just plug your account right into QuickBooks, and you can just as it posts in your checking account, you can label what it is, separates it into categories. QuickBooks has several different levels.
They pre-organize it. They know what items you're looking for on there. So.
And they actually do have for the self-employed, they have their own mileage app as well. So that it'll
Oh, really? So it all just kind of works together and streamlines. Okay. So. Tash, do you have any questions?
I was going to recommend a different app. I use Expensify.
Oh, Expensify. I've heard about Expensify as well.
How do you track your invoices that you're sending out in addition to mileage, and you can link it directly to your bank or bank statements.
Mm-hmm.
And you can take pictures of your receipts with your smartphone. Same as probably any of those.
I like QuickBooks.
Yeah. There's also for crafters and that, there's a crafty base that you can put your income and your expenses in, but you can also hook it up to some of the online sites like Etsy, and it will keep track of your fees in that as well.
Oh, that's interesting. Oh, so that's interesting too. Online fees
are
an expense, right? Mm-hmm. So Etsy, every time you upload something, it's 20 cents. It was
exactly.
20 cents. I don't know if it's more. Those are fees, so keep track of those. That's very important.
Mm-hmm.
Website. We talk about the maintenance on your website. If you buy a domain, that's an expense. So anything that has to do with your business.
Exactly.
That's online. One thing that I ran across, so I'm building Embrace Creatives.
Mm-hmm.
And I have put money into development, but the website isn't live. So I can't expense it yet. So that's something, if you're building a website for your business and you've put money into paying someone to build that website, but it's not live, by December 31st, you cannot expense that until the following year. So, right, you can hold on to it, and then as soon as that's dropped, as soon as it launches, that's when all of that money can get expensed. So I was very disappointed to find that out.
Viewer Carol likes QuickBooks Self-Employed. maybe there's another version of.
Yeah, that's the one that I was just speaking about. It's really nice. If they have an app, I've got it right on my phone, and you can plug it in right as you go and do stuff.
So what's the big difference between freelance and self-employed? What would be, what's easiest? Because I like easy. Are they both the same?
It's just a matter of what you need. QuickBooks, okay. it just builds according to what your needs are. You can start out self-employed.
Okay.
And as you grow, now you have employees, you step up to another level of QuickBooks that gives you payroll, and it's just whatever level you're at.
So freelance would, but then,
I believe freelance is this. And I may be wrong. Freelance might be the same as the self-employed, but I'd have to take a look at all of the different programs that they have. Because they've got entrepreneur, they've got self-employed, they've got.
Okay, so I think it's up to you guys to look at QuickBooks and kind of review the products and see what works
best. Yeah, you can speak to somebody who's QuickBooks certified and get a recommendation as to which one would be
best.
Which
would be best for you. Yeah. One thing I actually would like to talk about is sole proprietor versus LLC, but also a DBA. So there's a lot of artists out there that may not want to be a limited liability corporation right now. They may not be ready. They may not understand the benefits. Or they are an LLC and they may want to open another company. So what is it doing business as, and how could that be an advantage for an artist in any way? Or they don't need it because a sole proprietor, they can still do business under their name?
There'd probably be different tax advantages depending on what their different circumstances are, and if they have employees and how many and how they're employing them.
Right. A single artist who, like me, so I'm a jeweler and my name is Andrew Rosenfeld, but the name of my company that I sell my jewelry is Andrew Rosenfeld Design. So do I need a DBA? If someone pays me a check, they would just, or I could stay a sole proprietor and they would just write the check out to Andrew Rosenfeld.
You could stay a sole proprietor and have them make the check out to you directly.
To you directly, so the designs would fall off. The rest.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
With the changes that are coming up in 2018, the things that you want to look at though are, because as a sole proprietor, you're paying self-employment tax.
Yes.
And when you change your business entity, you've got pass-through entities that help cut out some of that extra tax that you're paying. So what's your volume? That's the type of thing. It doesn't matter if you're one person making this type of art or two people making this type of art. What's your volume? What are your sales looking like? Because you're coming up in 2018, and this is some of the stuff that we're learning about right now, all the reform, pass-through entities are getting an additional 20%.
So that means that being a sole proprietor is not beneficial for an artist in 2018. It's best to be...
It depends on what your revenue is, because... I mean, if your revenue is rather low, you're selling a lot, but your revenue is rather low, you've got expenses that are involved with being an LLC.
Right.
So you got to see what your balance is.
Right, right. The only expenses I find as an LLC is, what is it, every February 15th, it's $50, $25, something like that. I mean, that's the only yearly expense that I have with an LLC. Once it's filed, and you know, it's $50 to file, then it's just that yearly expense. Other than that, it's the benefits of being covered in case something happens, legally being covered in case something happens in your business. You're hanging a painting in a client's house and it falls on their foot. They can sue your business, they can't sue you. They can't take your house and they can't take your car, but they can.
I personally think that it's better when you're covered.
I do too. I tell all my students to become an LLC. It is worth the money. I teach them how to, at least in Michigan, how to file. It's $50. Show them how to do it on the form. And then it's just that yearly payment on the 15th. And then you're covered. And then at that point, you're saying, as an LLC, you get that extra pass-through deduction of 20% for as a self-employed. Because I'm a single member LLC. I'm not a partnership.
You're not a partnership, you're a single member LLC.
Right, and most artists are going to be. We work alone.
Most are. Yeah.
So are we going to still in 2018 get that?
I think possibly. It's S Corps that are the pastors, and I had to check with the LLC. S Corps. Yeah, you can be an LLC and be a sole proprietor, so it depends on how exactly you're set up. If you're set up as a pass-through entity, an S-Corp or something like that, it's the pass-throughs that are going to...
And what is a pass-through? Because I think a lot of people who are watching don't know what a pass-through is.
You need to file for S-Corporation status, and there are two separate returns that are done.
Okay.
You have to, as an S-Corporation, you have to take a wage. So that's something else that you've got to take into consideration. You have to have a salary for the year.
Okay.
So that's taken out of the total income.
Right.
And then, so then you're not paying self-employment on that. It's...
Right.
Yeah, it's a little more...
But then with the S-Corporation, you're not taxed. Your entity is not taxed alone. It's just passed through to your income. So you're not getting the double taxation that you do with a corporation.
Right.
It's taxed, and then you take money out, and then you're taxed again.
Right.
Also,
if you take money out, if you pay yourself.
Right.
I have no income, I don't pay myself primarily. I just LLC, I don't. I just need money for groceries. I just.
Exactly. Right. That would fall under the sole proprietorship.
Right. Exactly.
I think the benefit of the S Corporation would be that you wouldn't be taxed as a corporation, it would go through you, and you wouldn't have to pay so much as a self-employment tax.
Right. But then the downside is you have to work much harder to keep everything organized and to pay yourself. So I'm sure most artists are not going to become an S Corp.
I mean, it's a lot.
It's a lot more work. Now, with an S Corp and a C Corp, do you have to have the meetings? And do you have to have employees? Can you still be
S Corp is under 100 people.
Okay.
Under 100 members.
Okay.
New corporations are over.
Okay. Okay.
So corporations are
can be huge.
Taxed at their corporate rate. S Corps it flows through to your individual tax.
Okay. They're still associating a person with the corporation as an S Corp, right? As with a corporation, they're not. Any more questions coming in from?
No, not right now.
Okay. And what time do we have?
7:35.
Oh, we still have a half an hour.
Oh.
Let me go get my form and see if there's anything else we need to talk about.
That went so fast.
All right, well, let's talk a little bit about a hobby and a business. So I know that you talked about, needing to profit 2 out of 5 years. And the profit
can 3 out of 5, I'm sorry.
3 out of 5. 3 out of 5 years you have to profit. So if you start your business in 2017, count 5 years. If you profited 3 out of those 5 years, then you are considered a business, not a hobby. I think a lot of artists may be scared to be a business and not a hobby because there's a lot more work. And that's true. So a lot of artists will sell things and not report it and not pay sales tax and kind of fly under the radar. But do you find that if they're doing that and they're selling a lot and all of a sudden they want to become a business, does that hurt them at all if they're doing this kind of under the radar for 3 or 4 years and all of a sudden want to jump into?
I think they're missing out on some deductions that they can take.
So that's the basic thing, are deductions that they're missing out on because they're not claiming that they're a business.
Because if you take a loss and you're just a hobby, you can only take a loss up to your income. If your business income was $5,000 and you had a $6,000 loss, you'd only be able to take match the income, which is $5,000, and then you'd have to reduce that by your adjusted gross income. So you wouldn't be able to take a loss amount. You would have to just claim zero income.
Yeah, so if you start, if you're starting out, as most people do, you're not making a whole lot to start off with.
And you
in
many
those
more
first
expenses.
Few years, it's
right.
You've got a loss that you're going to take that's going to lower your taxable income.
Right.
So those first few years, it kind of helps give you that little bit of a
right, and that's how the cushion. Government helps, because they help you save money. So you're spending the first couple, I remember as a jeweler, the beads that I bought, the money that I spent, and you're amassing your
right.
materials and your tools, and you're buying all these things, and you spent $10,000 to get set up. If you're not a business, you can't claim that
right.
as a
you're
deduction.
Just playing that hobby, you can, it'll
right.
let you earn $20,000.
Right, exactly. Right.
It gives you a little bit more, depending on your circumstances again, but
right.
that loss can help give you a little more money to play with to
right.
go get a few more things to help stock up.
Exactly.
So you're missing out on that.
So the expenses are really all about saving money and getting mm-hmm. money back at the end of the year. So you spent all this money, now you're getting a portion of it back that you
right.
can reinvest in your business.
Exactly.
Reinvest in your business.
Reinvest in your business.
And then, or a lot of, what else I think I want to talk about? Jumping.
That's fine.
Paying your taxes. So I set aside money and
yeah.
I pay quarterly, but let's talk about paying your taxes
yeah,
as a small
tax
business.
Payments.
And we're
that's
not talking about sales tax, we're talking about actual income tax. So yeah, talk
right.
about that.
Yes. If you are expecting in the year to owe over $1,000 in federal sales tax, I'm sorry, in federal income tax, after you've already subtracted your withholdings and you've made all your calculations and now you've got to pay the government more than $1,000, that's an instance where you should have been paying estimated sales tax. I'm sorry, I keep saying sales tax and I don't mean to, because we were talking about sales
income tax. Yes.
Yeah. You should have been making estimated tax payments, and these are things that you get penalized, then penalties and interest can add up fairly quickly.
Right.
So there's a schedule every year, four times a year, based on what your sales and that are. You pay in a portion ahead of time, and then you can avoid the penalties and interest. Overall, you're going to owe the same amount of tax at the end of the year, but if you're not paying it until the end of the year, you're going to be paying much, much more.
Right.
So you want to make sure that you're keeping track. Again, making sure you're keeping track, keeping good records, and making your payments throughout the year.
When do you make those payments?
Each year is slightly different on the dates, but it's roughly, April 18th, 2018. I've got the dates for this.
Okay.
The exact ones?
I have the exact ones for 2018, yes.
Okay,
so April 18th. 4/18, and that is for payment period January 1 to January 31st.
So this is the first quarter?
Yeah.
Okay.
And it doesn't go exactly quarter by quarter.
Okay.
Just to...
Okay.
Okay, so then June 15th is going to be your next one.
Okay.
And that's from April 1st to May 31st.
Okay.
So that's only 2 months. Yeah.
Okay.
The next one is due September 17th. And that is for payment period June 1st through August 31st.
Okay.
And then January 15th, 2019. And that is for September 1st through December 31st.
And one thing you can do, I do with my account, let's say I'm getting money back at the end of the year. This is kind of hard to say now, that I don't want it all, but I want to kind of prepare for the next year.
Mm-hmm.
I tell my accountant, pretend you didn't say that whole number,
mm-hmm.
and give me half, and then take the other half and credit my next year's taxes.
Yeah,
so
that's something you can do when you're filing.
When you're filing,
yes.
You can do that. When you know that you're going to be getting a refund of $500, mm-hmm. if you just say, give me two, and put three is a credit to my federal and one is a credit to my state,
mm-hmm.
for the year 2018. That means that as you pay these different quarters, you're going to pay less. You're going to pay less because they are. But again, they're holding your money. The federal government is holding your money. You're not now reinvesting in your business. So you really have to think about where you want that money to go, because when you get that tax money back, you really should put it back in your business. You shouldn't be celebrating and buying things for yourself. That is a reinvestment,
exactly.
So, But you can, if you want to kind of stave off, if you feel that, you know, something's happening next year, you know you're going to be switching gears, you know it's a big year, you may not be working, you may not be selling as much for whatever reason, maybe you're switching from clay to fiber and it's a totally different industry, you can say, I'm going to kind of preempt this and put money, and tell your account to put to credit the money.
Exactly.
Yeah.
If you know that you're already booking more exhibits, you're booking more shows.
Right. Right, and you know that you're going to be, right, exactly.
You've got the possibility to sell more because you're at more events.
Yeah. Now let's talk about filing for a minute. So obviously, your accountants, and you want to go to account because I feel that you just know more than me. So if I went to TurboTax online, I would be completely lost, and I'm sure that there's ways to do it. I mean, my daughter, who is in college, who works at Starbucks, can do that. Mm-hmm. She has an income. She gets, what is it, W-2. She gets her W-2s. Yeah, that's like workday jobs. I'm an entrepreneur. So it's simple. It's simple. But for an artist who has a lot of deductions and expenses, right, and all that, you know, what can a person, and I know it's different states and different accounting firms, but an average of how much they should expect to pay. And I know that every case is different because someone may come in and say, hey, I'm a single mom and I have alimony and child support as well as, so it's definitely different, but
yeah, it's different based on everybody's situation and what type of forms you have to file and all that. But a sole proprietor, you're looking on average around 500 base.
Okay.
You're individual that doesn't have their own business, you know, an average on that is around 350, so that when I put the business on there, it's not unreasonable.
Every to
think. Adds
a little more.
Yeah. Adds a little more, right.
And
it's an
important schedule that you need to file with for your business. So.
Right. And so for me, the benefit of investing in your business and hiring an accountant that you like, and it really has to be someone that you like and gets you. Something very interesting, so I work with my accountant, and every year he looks at me and says, you have such an interesting life. Because really, when you're doing this, you see what's coming in, and you look at all of there, you can see what they've done the whole year.
It's kind of cool. Someone's life, and you get to see.
Yeah.
It's like living through somebody else's eyes.
Exactly. But of course, they have to understand the creative, you know, business and really what's best for us. But in what way do you think that working with an accountant and investing that $500, $600, or whatever it is that you do, how does that save the money? How does that save the money?
Yeah, the two areas I would think would be saving yourself from costly mistakes by doing something incorrectly.
Right.
And getting credit for something you may not know that you can get credit for.
Right.
That's where people lose a lot of money, is they don't realize that there are these types of credits or these types of expenses that can be taken. You're not doing it incorrectly.
Right.
But the government's not going to say, hey, if you'd have done this, you can get an extra $200 off of your tax bill for this year.
Right.
So I think that's where it benefits.
If you're a company that you have a lot of things going on where you have to file sales tax, you have to pay for income taxes and everything, and a lot of people just let that go to the wayside because they're so busy running their business, and then they get, you know, these letters from the IRS or in the state of Michigan.
Right.
Well, the other thing too is we all know how fast our government works. Mm-hmm. The IRS works just as quickly.
Right.
So there, you may have a small error now, but they don't get around to discovering it until a couple of years from now, and now you've got the penalty and interest that is going to pile up between now and then, and that's where your one small error can really bite you.
Right. So a couple things to say on that. The first, I have something that just happened, nothing major. So I moved from New York back home to Michigan 4 years ago. So I moved in the summer of 2013. So when I filed in 2014, I was living in Michigan. So I filed my federal, mm-hmm. but I filed New York State because for pretty much the whole month of the whole year I was in New York. I just got a letter from our state, from Michigan State, that says, "Hi, we see that you used a Michigan address to file your federal taxes in 2014. Where's your state taxes? Pay us, you owe us money." So I had to go downstairs and move a million boxes and go into my 2014 folder, and I suggest, how many years do we have to keep records? Is it 7 years? Is it 10 years?
7 years.
7 years. Keep them for longer if you have the room.
And I pulled it out,
and I found my state, because they said you have to send us your entire state return. So I did. I found my New York state. I didn't have a copy of the check. Should you keep copies of the checks that you send? I mean, my right now we file electronically, but if you write a check, should you keep a copy of that check in with your?
That would be a good idea.
Just to
show. It's not a bad idea to keep a copy of it. You can get an electronic record through your bank.
Right. But this was 2014.
Right.
I was living in New York. I would have to literally find. And I was like, should I find the check? I didn't. So, but I had those records, I made copies, they told me what number, and I sent them out, and I would just pray, and be like, oh yeah, everything's fine, we won't bother you again. But it is scary getting something from the federal government. I don't want to deal with that. So I was like, thank God I hold on myself. So hold your records for 7 years, put them in a manila envelope, and
it's tedious, it can be time consuming, but it is worth it in the end.
Just like Cheryl said, now this was from 2014, so this was 2013 taxes. It is now 5 years later.
Yeah, now imagine that that's something, it was some sort of a transaction or something that you filed wrong on the form. Now you can remember exactly what happened 4 years ago throughout your entire business.
But now with scanners and computers, you could just scan everything and get rid of the papers.
Electronic copy of the thing.
And there's some things I find too, so sometimes you get those receipts and they're on that really shiny paper, and they wear off.
That's something that's really nice, and I'm sure other programs have it as well, but QuickBooks, the self-employed, and I believe the other programs as well, you can take a snapshot of it and it'll attach it right to your expense in the program. So take a picture of it, scan it, get a copy of it before it starts to fade.
Before it starts to fade. And now, what are you supposed to be writing on our receipts? I write on all my receipts when I do something and I go to a place and a parking garage. Okay, a parking garage, because I came here today and I paid for parking. What do you write down on the receipt?
Tie it to a certain event.
So the name of the event, the date is already on there.
The name of the event, yeah.
You don't have to say if you were a participant, just that you went. It doesn't matter. It's just the name of the event and the date.
As long as you know what that event was and you can explain what it is.
Okay, good. Yeah, I mean, when I do, if I'm in a meeting and it's a lunch meeting, I write the name of the company. Sometimes I write the name of the person that I meet,
The name of the person as well.
But that's
taking it. I can't imagine that they would actually call.
When it comes to travel and meals, those types of expenses, the more detail that you are able to provide, the better it is.
Right. Okay, so I have a question thinking about travel. Go to New York to visit my family, but I stop in at an arts nonprofit and talk to them about the possibility of me teaching there the next year. How much of that can I deduct any of that trip? It's not the full trip I really went in, or is it really there's it's not
what was the basis of the trip?
The basis was personal. So if the basis is personal, then okay. So really when you travel, if you want to deduct the travel, it has to be for business.
Right.
Okay. So you really have to be going for business. It can't be personal and then you throw business in and think that you can.
Right. You can't just throw a little bit of business in there and think that you're going to be able to write off your entire.
Okay.
Right. But some people do go on a business trip and then they'll extend the family vacation. It could be 50-50.
Okay.
Now, if you were, say you went and you met with someone, you'd be able to claim that if you went and met for lunch or something like that.
Okay.
Now you'd be able to claim.
Or a train ride to get from my hotel
to get. Exactly.
Okay, so anything surrounding that part, but that can't be any part of the plane or any part of the hotel, or it's just really whatever
happened.
Yeah, if
you're on a family trip and you have a specific, you have one specific thing that happened that was business.
Right.
Anything that's tied to it.
Right. Because I have a client that's going on business to the West Coast, but while she's there, she's going to look at galleries because there's galleries there that we want her to get in. So I'll let her know that. And she knows, I mean, it's being paid for. She's an employee, so she's probably not doing anything out of pocket. But I'll tell her
that she's taking the receipts. Taking the bus from the hotel down to the galleries and stuff like
exactly.
that. Hold on
exactly.
to those receipts.
Okay. I don't know. I think. Is there any other questions?
No, on that's
Facebook
it.
That's it? Okay, guys. Thank you so much. Again, Linda Franskoviak. And Cheryl, and now I'm Cheryl Olson of Franskoviak & Cohn. I'm Andrea Rosenfeld of Embrace Creatives. This is Creative Taxes Think Tank. We're going to have another one next month. I'm not going to tell you. I have an exciting announcement that I'll put on my Facebook group, who I'm partnering with for the next, like, probably the rest of the year to do Think Tank. So I'm really excited. Again, embracecreatives.com.